The Tom Woods Show, episode 983.
Prepare to set fire to the index card of allowable opinion. Your daily dose of liberty education starts here. The Tom Woods Show.
Folks, everybody always thinks the current U.S. president must be the worst, but man, is there competition for that title. Check out our free course on the presidents and their crimes against liberty at freehistorycourse.com. Hello, everybody. Tom Woods here, and I am very glad to be joined once again by our old friend Gene Epstein, who is economics and book review editor over at Barron's, the nation's premier financial publication. And we're going to talk today about happiness research. We've talked about this a bit quite a long time ago on the show, but it's being used, well, for obviously partisan purposes, and we'll get into that in just a minute. Gene, welcome back to the show.
Thanks so much, Tom, and congratulations on your recent milestone, 100th episode on Contra Krugman, and the impending 1,000th episode on the Tom Woods Show, and may there be many thousands more.
Very kind of you to say. Thank you. All right, before we get into our topic for today, mm-hmm. I do want to give you an opportunity to say something about the wonderful Soho Forum. I'm going to be in New York in early October, so I actually went to the website to see mm-hmm. if there's going to be a Soho Forum debate while I'm in town, but it's the following week, so I'm crushed.
Okay.
But if I lived in New York, there's no way I would let a month go by without. I'm amazing debates on important topics with interesting people. So tell people about it and what's coming up, how they can find out about it, how they can get a free drink, the whole story.
I definitely will. And first of all, happy you'll be in New York, and I'll be able to encounter you there because you're just going to be a few blocks away. And so I'm looking forward to the Mises conference, and that'll be fun. But getting back to my Soho Forum, we had a very successful season in 2016, 2017, 11 episodes spaced out from September through July. And we're taking August off, but once again, we have a whole lineup of seven debates already scheduled to begin with from September through February. Debates that are indeed, of course, geared to the interests of freedom-loving folks. And the offer still goes. The offer, of course, famously, infamously, so to speak, I said that anybody who comes up to me and just mouths the words, Tom Woods gets a free drink at the bar, alcohol and non-alcoholic. And in fact, two people already took me up on that. And I hope there will be many more. So please go to thesohoforum.org, look at our schedule. Normally our debates are early in the week, in the middle of the month. We have debates spanning from September through February. And if you're an out-of-towner but planning to be in New York around those times, then please come and please come up to me and collect your drink. The name Tom Woods is now, exchanged for a drink. And that's, of course, never have you had such an honor, Tom, and I'm happy to bestow it on you. So please collect on the Tom Woods, just say it, and you get a free drink.
That's amazing.
So how can you say no to that?
Exactly. That's wonderful. Maybe someday, if I'm able to make it, I'll come up to you and say Tom Woods, and I want my free drink.
That's right.
All right.
That's right. You'll just have to remember your own name, Tom. That's all. That's all that's expected.
Yeah, that I know I can do. So you had a recent column on a topic that I hit on a long, long time ago on the show, which is happiness research.
Wow.
Yeah, because I had somebody on, a professor of economics in Denmark, because uh-huh. we were getting this whole thing about Denmark being the happiest country in the world. Now apparently Norway is the happiest country in the world.
And yeah, but Denmark, I guess, is still up there. Good idea. Yeah.
Right, right. Uh-huh. So they're drawing, as you know, all these policy conclusions from why these people, as to why these people must be happy. And he came on to address that. But that was probably back in my first 100 or so episodes. That was really early. So nobody remembers anything about that. So now you're going to carry the torch here on the happiness research. What is the point of your column, The Happiness Conundrum? What's the UN trying to convince us of now?
Well, I should emphasize that I owe a lot to Tom DiLorenzo, who I gather is going to be a featured guest on your 1,000th show.
Yep.
Tom did a very good piece a few years back on the happiness research, and he basically showed that it's nakedly all about enhancing government power over our lives. And I essentially am doing an update of Tom DiLorenzo's findings by focusing on the World Happiness Report 2017, published in association with the United Nations, in which they very specifically state, happily, no doubt, that happiness is increasingly considered the proper measure of social progress and the goal of public policy. And I think that it's important to ask yourself, why is it? Is it really true that only the interventionists and the collectivists are interested in happiness? Well, you know, everybody is sort of interested in happiness. One hopes that we are interested, as the Declaration of Independence stated, in the pursuit of happiness, in pursuing happiness in our own way, or perhaps perversely, as David Friedman once put it, the libertarian creed that every man has a right to go to hell in his own fashion, just like we all have a right to be happy in our own fashion, the various views of happiness. It's all very interesting. Why is it that we are not interested in the idea of measuring happiness specifically on a scale of 0 to 10 and then ranking 155 countries in terms of the happiness that prevails in each country, as the UN has done? Well, you know, I would say that while Tom is absolutely right to point out that Murray Rothbard specifically early on inveighed against the idea that there can be what's called cardinal utility, that we can actually measure satisfaction or the utility that you get out of something. We can only talk about it ordinally. In other words, that we prefer one thing to another. We can't say, well, we prefer it twice as much as we prefer the other thing. We can't really talk in those terms. And by and large, the standard economics textbooks by now sort of give the nod to that point. And so that in itself should explode the idea that happiness can actually be measured, and that the happiness prevailing in each country, 155 countries around the world, can be measured. So that, in other words, you don't even have to be a libertarian or a classical liberal to dismiss the idea. But I think sort of a deeper point is that even if you don't think about it, the idea, if you're a libertarian, if you just agree with the non-aggression principle, you sort of implicitly understand that human beings are a highly diverse lot in terms of abilities, attitudes, goals, and so on, and that nobody's happiness can be put along the same metric. On the other hand, if you're power hungry, if you love the idea of government dominating our lives, then you sort of want to believe that we're all sort of, you know, slightly automaton types, and that our happiness can be measured. So I think that that's sort of at the root of it. But meanwhile, of course, in the column, I tried to have a lot of fun at the happiness people's expense.
When I had as I mentioned, a professor on, his name was Christian Bjørnskov from Denmark. When I had him on, he was answering the claim that the reason everybody in Denmark is happy is because of the Scandinavian welfare state policy.
Oh, yeah.
And what he said was, the problem with that is that that does not explain ongoing happiness. He says something like that, that's static, that's in the background, your welfare state policy, becomes part of your baseline expectations for your life. Same way you get a new car, you have a burst of happiness, but then it becomes the baseline of your expectations going on from that point. Mm-hmm. So, he was inclined to place the explanation for the I don't think he was necessarily saying there's no value in happiness research, but he thought that the tremendous amount of social trust that existed in Denmark could account for that, although I'm not sure why that wouldn't also be just background noise in effect. But but the point is, it is not by any means a home run to say, well, they have a big welfare state. And Tom DiLorenzo points out that one of the critics of some of these happiness researchers who have said that if you have less inequality, you have more of these other happy, good results, mental health, physical health, intelligence, all that. And you could do exactly the same thing by plotting recycling against suicide. And it turns out that high recycling countries are also high suicide countries. What the heck does that prove?
Well, no, absolutely. Speaking of countries like Denmark, like Sweden, like Norway, which now gets number one rating, you know, I don't, on the one hand, it's ridiculous from my standpoint, and I think from the standpoint of anybody who respects, you know, social science, as we might call it, that this is just mad scientist ideas. And specifically, a couple of points that are interesting are that these particular happiness researchers, I actually didn't do a huge survey of the literature like Tom did. I just read this happiness report carefully. They pin it on one question that is put to what is supposedly a sample of people that essentially boils down to the idea, on a scale of 0 to 10, how do you rate yourself in terms of happiness? They give it a lot of pseudoscience by talking about a ladder, that if you imagine a ladder and the ladder has a 0 rung and a rung and a 10th rung, where would you place yourself on the ladder? And I mean, it's clear enough that, I mean, this of course is a throwback to the old male chauvinist rating women as sex objects on a scale of 0 to 10. This is their so-called science in supposedly deciding that Denmark has more happy people, proportionately more happy people than, say, the United Kingdom does. I found, speaking of suicide, I found that that four of the countries in the top 10, the U.S. ranks 14th, that four of the countries in the top 10, which are Iceland, Switzerland, Finland, and Sweden, have unusually high suicide rates, noticeably higher suicide rates than a number of countries that come in a lot lower, like the United Kingdom, Chile, Mexico, Spain, Germany. I thought this was a little bit anomalous, especially since, if you have a high suicide rate, there are multiple numbers of people who might be on the brink of suicide, sort of unhappy. And then the happiness researchers resolve this by pointing out that, well, you know, it's the flip side of misery loves company. If you're living in a happy country and you tend to be very sad, you're going to become even sadder if you hang around with a bunch of very happy people. And so, I mean, I think this is all absurd. And all beyond measure. I mean, the other irony that I talked about was that they think that it's fascinating that in China, over the years, there was a near tripling of gross domestic product, huge increase in economic output because of market reforms and because of an increase in economic freedom. And yet, the Chinese got a little lower on their 0 to 10 happiness scale. And they, of course, since they're always looking for government solutions to problems that they want to create, they attributed this to problems that government might be able to address. But I point out there's also the obvious explanation of the revolution of rising expectations, namely that Chinese today have much wider horizons. So perhaps they regard that 9th and 10th rung on the ladder as less attainable than it used to be when they were poor. And so this is all just sort of a riot of ridiculousness in terms of rating countries and finding out how happy they are. As a research assistant of mine said, if he were filling out this ladder question, he would bear in mind the 9th and 10th rung on the ladder is sort of like the most dangerous and highest rung. So I know, a little dangerous, who knows who can be up there? Or some people might even spurn the question altogether. So it is ridiculous. But getting back to your question about Denmark, I think, of course, obviously it is a bit unanswerable as to why in this particular case the Danes tend to put themselves on higher rungs of the ladder than the Germans do. But I don't think it means anything. It just means, you know, how do Germans react to questions about ladders and 0 to 10 versus the way the Danes do or the way the Swedes do, despite their high high suicide rate. It's all ridiculous. Although I would say that, you know, the idea that that the welfare state is in any way helpful in these very tiny countries. I mean, all of these countries, Sweden, Denmark, Norway. Norway has a population of 5 million. Denmark, 8 million. These countries have a low have a smaller population than New York City, and they're very homogeneous. You know, it gets back to the old quip from Milton Friedman when he was told we have no poverty in Sweden, and Milton Friedman responded by saying, that's interesting, we have no poverty among Swedish Americans either. You know, it's all about their culture and their cohesiveness, and I'm prepared to believe that people who believe who live in relatively homogeneous small cultures tend to be happier, tend to have a greater sense of group identification. That's I'm sure is the case, but it obviously means nothing in terms of what anybody can really demonstrate. And if you actually read, ironically, the New York Times had begun a couple of years ago to write exposés about the same sort of social pathologies of the Danish welfare state that we find in our much larger country of the United States. People are probably less happy in the United States when they make the Faustian bargain with disability payments and they drop out of the labor force and they have nothing to do with themselves except get high on opioids that are paid for by Medicaid. That's probably most of our judgment would be that's not the way of happiness, and of course that's due to government intervention. And indeed, there is a lot of abuse of the Danish welfare system. The Danes don't need their government welfare system. I'm sure they're plenty charitable toward the relative handful of Danes who might have financial hardship through no fault of their own. And so that could be solved very easily in a small, cohesive country like Denmark without the apparatus of the welfare state. But with respect to the question you ask, why do the Danes, generally speaking, answer these surveys saying that they're happier? Why do the Swedes? I think it's mysterious. We don't really know. But the main point to make is that this is all pseudoscience anyway.
Your point about how people in different countries might simply respond to questions like this, questions where there's no unit, there's no happiness unit. So it reminded me of something I read in a book by Thomas Sowell, one of his lesser known books.
Yeah.
He has a book called Inside American Education. In that book, he reports on an interesting study that showed that when you ask 13-year-old Korean children, do you believe you are good at math? 23% said yes.
Oh, wow.
When you ask American children, do you believe you're good at math? 68% said yes, even though they're much worse than Koreans. Koreans are much better than they are at math. And yet you ask them what seems to be an objective question about their own skills, and you get dramatically different results. And the results are exactly the opposite of what they ought to be. Mm-hmm. So it seems to me the happiness research falls somewhere on that spectrum.
No, absolutely. I tend to think that people are sort of secure in themselves, for whom sort of like, you know, the pursuit of happiness is the way to happiness. I was trying to look for an insight of all people, John Stuart Mill, who certainly had, for all his faults, certainly had strong libertarian tendencies, that what he had learned is that thinking about happiness and focusing on being happy is not the way to be happy. You know, that not thinking about it is the best way to be happy, the paradox, the irony of happiness. And so I tend to believe that people who are secure and content in themselves, some of the people who I've met, are unlikely to put themselves, when asked this absurd question, imagine a ladder and the zero rung is the least happy and the 10th rung is the most happy, they would tend to put themselves on, like the middle rung, you know, if you want to think about it, because oftentimes they don't think about it. But people who read all kinds of books about how to be happy and self-help books, who are sort of deeply unhappy, will put themselves on higher rungs of the ladder, for all we know. So probably, just as you indicate, the same sort of irony applies, where people who are better at math rate themselves lower than people who are worse at math, and so on. So again, it's all pretty ridiculous. Although, I also want to say that when we think in terms of of the way in which the idea of happiness collides with the values of a libertarian. We find, of course, that the happiness researchers, since government can solve the problem of inequality by simply taking from some people and giving money to others, this sort of collides with our sense of something else, which is which is rights, human rights, and the non-aggression principle of the 10th, the commandment club, as one economist put it. Thou shalt not covet. And certainly we know people who are smitten and suffused by envy are deeply unhappy, and the only way for them to become less unhappy is to try to get past that, to quit looking at what other people have and what other people have achieved and becoming more secure in yourself. But the happiness researchers want to keep that going, want to keep you deeply unhappy with being with inequality, with the fact that somebody else, your neighbor, has more than you have, and by fanning the flames of that unhappiness, they want to intervene. But of course, we know that that's a never-ending spiral. People who compare themselves with others will never be happy, because there will always be crucial ways in which they won't have things that others have, and so they will always be unhappy. And the happiness researchers are therefore only fanning the flames of unhappiness by constantly emphasizing the issue of inequality.
Does it seem to you like the happiness research, now maybe there's some merit to it, who knows, right? But it seems to me anyway, just as an outside observer, that it's something very slippery that can be used to push the, let's say, political agenda of the researchers.
Like,
I'm just sitting here reporting the facts, people. But what are we supposed to conclude when Norway's number one? Well, it must be because they have daycare for kids or something.
Well, sure. And I mean, look, I'm going to respond to you, Tom, by saying I only read this report of the UN, associated with the UN, on a scale of 0 to 10, and then they try to correlate it with other variables. Scale of 0 to 10, on the latter, how happy are you? And I'm supposed to believe that, again, that the U.S. is 14, and that even though a country like the United Kingdom has a lower suicide rate than Sweden, they're less happy there, Germany is less happy. The Germans are less happy than the Americans. I don't see that any of this means anything. But of course, as you indicate, the whole reason for this research, or for this war paint, is to try to associate unhappiness or unhappiness with things that government can do. Now, clearly, the Norwegians. What makes the Norwegians reasonably happy? Well, they're 5 million people, essentially a little bit more than half the population of the United States, basically a fairly homogeneous group, and they're sitting on a mountain of oil, and they really don't need a government to sort of run it, because they'd be living well without a massive government intervention. But they're quite rich. They're massive in per capita. They export more oil per capita than any other country in the world, and certainly including Saudi Arabia. And so they're rich. They're cohesive. Most of them are Norwegian, to the extent, by and large, that they have immigrants. But the immigrants are often usually Scandinavian, because a number of these countries do have now Muslim immigrants that are causing trouble. On the other hand, this isn't something that faces them all the time. So if somebody wants to argue that actually having a purpose in life, having a cohesive society, all of those things makes for happiness, that's great. I would say that on the other side, the U.S., with its 330 million people, of course, is a racially torn society. It's got all kinds of problems of different kinds that are unique to a country this size, but it also has a much more honorable tradition than these other countries of reducing the unhappiness of the poor people of the world by allowing immigrants to come to our country. And that's, of course, that's the main reason I'm here, because my grandparents were allowed to come to this country and flee flee the miserable state they were in Eastern Europe and in Russia. And so there are all kinds of complications and issues. I think Charles Murray, for example, is a very good, essentially sort of conservative libertarian who's written very movingly about the consequential life. I was looking for some quotes on happiness, and I noticed something from Henry Hazlitt, who talked about the purest happiness in his youth was spent browsing in a library. You know, that, and indeed, that's part of what did the founding fathers mean by the government securing the right to the pursuit of happiness? Well, maybe they meant, when they talked about happiness, maybe they meant the pursuit of knowledge. All of those, but they certainly did not, since they were essentially libertarian in the Declaration of Independence, that government should guarantee us the right to the pursuit of happiness. They said absolutely nothing about how we define that pursuit, how we personally define happiness. So therefore, my point is in basic agreement with you that it's fascinating and stirring often for people who have a sense of themselves to talk about the keys to happiness. For Henry Hazlitt, by the way, he struck a responsive chord in me about browsing at a bookstore or browsing in a library where there are a lot of books on a subject that you love, and the intense, the purest happiness he felt when he was doing that. You know, and the happiness we feel in having children, the delirium. I mean, when my daughter was born, that was my firstborn, I would break into tears of happiness for the next 48 hours. So let's by all means share our insights into happiness and share insights into what makes for happiness. By and large, of course, it's having a purpose in life for most of us. On the other hand, since we are libertarians, we respect other people's rights to pursue happiness in their own way, as long as they don't do it to the detriment of other people's rights.
And with that, we're going to call it quits for today. That is the happiness research. That's what you need to know about it, right? Unless you want to make yourself miserable the rest of your life. That's the irony of it. Spending too much time with the happiness research makes you miserable, right?
Especially coveting and envying other people and getting focused on the inequality between me and somebody else. You know, I'll recall a moment in my own life. I worked at the New York Stock Exchange as a senior economist, and I used to enjoy biking 7 miles back and forth to work in Manhattan. I was a bit of a nut that way. I was getting on my bike, and I noticed the chairman of the New York Stock Exchange was getting into his limo, and I thought, well, I can't afford a limo, but I'm happier on my bike. I don't envy him in the slightest.
Right.
So I felt quite happy on my bike, and that's the kind of happiness I want to hold on to.
If only we had more Gene Epsteins in the world. Think of how much better things would be. Thanks so much, Gene. Appreciate it.
Thanks a lot. Bye-bye.
All right, everybody. Check out this website created by a listener. It's carlhoniger.com, H-O-N-E-G-G-E-R.com. He says, I'm currently using the website for my campaign for city council for Broomfield, Colorado. He says, I first got involved in local politics by getting elected as a precinct delegate to the state convention in Colorado to support Dr. Ron Paul in 2012. I was also homeschooled all the way, K-12, and believe it was helpful to inspire a lifetime of learning. He says, I work in an accounting department as a treasury analyst and want to combine my background in financial accountability with my promise of holding to the non-aggression principle if I were to serve on city council. Broomfield is a combined city and county and is also Colorado's newest and smallest county. It is also the fifth smallest county in the nation. So check out what he's trying to do over at carlhoniger.com, H-O-N-E-G-G-E-R.com. I'll link to it at tomwoods.com/983 as well. And make sure and get your bonuses, including free publicity from me, a bunch of nice tutorials to get you up and running as a blogger, membership in my private bloggers group, and a nice backlink on my site that'll give you a little SEO juice. So check out how you can get all those things at tomwoods.com/publicity. Mark Ripito joins me tomorrow. See you then.
Become a smarter libertarian in just 30 minutes a day. Visit TomWoods.com to subscribe to the show for free, and we'll see you next time.